Pinterest is a visual bookmarking tool to help you discover and save creative ideas. Hopefully some of you use it. But today I'm going to talk about something I think we might have heard a little bit about earlier today. You might have seen some clickbaity headlines about, is SEO dead? So let's get right into it. Is SEO still an important growth channel? My answer is short answer yes with an if, long answer no with a but. It really all depends on your business. But first let's talk about why could it matter? So Andrew Chen has a great blog post on there being really three ways that you can grow big. One is SEO, one is virality, and one is paid. So SEO is one of the few channels with true scale to help you go 0 to 100. The other thing that's great about SEO is that it actually, you don't have to spend money on it. The cost is engineering opportunity cost, right? So the cost of SEO is, what would your engineers be doing if they weren't working on SEO? I've worked on virality, I've worked on SEO, I've worked on paid. Paid sucks, I prefer to work on this. So it's really, you wanna find out if this can be something that can drive leverage and growth for your business. So how do you figure out if SEO is a big opportunity for you? In certain cases, it could be a very big opportunity. In some cases, it can be not an opportunity at all. In some cases, it can be very competitive. And in some cases, it can be not very competitive. So what you want to figure out is, what are things people are searching for on search engines that are relevant for my business? And if I do some best practices, create some landing pages for those sorts of keywords, can I reasonably expect to rank and get a lot of customers from it? So what you hope to be is in this slide, which is in the top right, where there's a lot of search volume, but it's not very competitive. This is food delivery in 2008 when I joined Grubhub. But actually, it's pretty rare that you have those opportunities these days. This tends to happen when something's just coming online for the first time, or where there's a really emerging trend that's rapidly becoming popular. Most of these opportunities don't exist anymore. They're just very few. But if you actually move down to the bottom right, if it's not a competitive space and there's not very much search volume, this is actually okay, especially when you're starting a business, because you can own the few searches that do happen relatively easily for your business, have a high conversion rate on them, and then start to move to this top left category that's a little bit more competitive, which is maybe in that specific case, things about the broader industry, more competitive terms. If you do happen to find yourself in this top left quadrant where it's competitive, but there's high search volume, it's not a reason to dismay. It's just maybe a reason not to expect a short-term gain. So, think real estate, very competitive for SEO. The companies that dominate this space on SEO, your Zillow, your Trulia, your Redfin, these companies, they build their entire company around how can we rank better on search engines. Engineering teams, product teams, marketing, PR, all thinking about how can I improve our rankings. That's what you need to do, and that is a long-term game. You really have to make it a core competency of your company, and if you can do that, you can still win. If you do happen to be in this bottom left category, don't worry about SEO. Don't pay attention to the rest of my presentation. Go let your competitors waste their time trying to impress Google. You find another growth channel that works. So the question you might be asking is, well, how do I know what box I'm in? And the first question you need to ask is, what keywords are relevant for my business? So the way I like to think of it is who, what, when, where, and how. So for a company like Pinterest, where it does a lot of different things, has content in a lot of different categories, this is a pretty hard question to answer. It's not a great example. So let's take my previous business, Grubhub. So who for Grubhub? Is obviously the brand name at every restaurant that Grubhub represents. The what is, anything that Grubhub does, any keyword related to that. So food, delivery, every cuisine type, menus. The when, in Grubhub's case, is what time people eat, right? So that's breakfast, lunch, dinner, late night. The where is every city, neighborhood, school, zip code, province, that you cover, which in Grubhub's case, rapidly expanding that. So you need to make sure you brainstorm every one of those. And then the how is typically technically how you solve the problem. In Grubhub's case, it's online ordering, mobile app. These are not super searched on the consumer side, but for B2B, these are the things that tend to get more searched. So what you do is you take all of those keywords, you put them in Excel, you mash them all together, all the different, you know, Vancouver food delivery, University of BC Thai menus. You come up with all those combinations, and then you just go to the AdWords keyword planner. You upload a CSV or you paste those keywords in, and Google will tell you exactly how many searches all of these terms are getting. It's a free tool. All you need to do is sign up for AdWords. You don't need to set up paid ads. And it is grain of salty. It'll say like 10,000 searches, not 10,147, but it gives you a really good read. They also do tell you how competitive those terms are, but it's based on AdWords competitiveness, not the organic side competitiveness. So I tend to ignore that. And I tend to just figure out, okay, here are the terms that I searched for on the keyword planner that have the most searches. Let me just go do a bunch of spot searches of those terms and see how good they are. Are the people that are ranking providing really good results, are they themselves good at SEO? And to know if that's the case, you probably need to know a little bit of like, well, how do I know if they're good at SEO? So the short answer is, just do they have really good landing pages? Like, do they impress you with the results that come up? Is it a bunch of blog posts coming up? Or is it a really strong landing page getting someone to convert for something very related to that product? The long answer is, are they relevant and are they authoritative? So I mentioned blog posts as an example of something that's not super competitive. Content marketing can be a great SEO strategy, but generally the people that are doing this at scale, they're doing this super well, are not writing content, right? They are have a way to scale thousands of pages that are relevant for tons of terms. Some they probably haven't even thought of themselves, but they're automatically there. So there's kind of a couple ways to think about doing this. So marketplace like Grubhub, you can get the data from the supply side, right? All the restaurants you sign up, you have their menu information, you have the times they're open. That's something that you can throw up there and it's relevant for search engines. Later on in Grubhub's case, you start to get reviews of all of these restaurants. That's user-generated content. That's also great for search engines and it scales. In the case of Pinterest, it is all user-generated content. We have over 50 billion pins. Pinterest didn't add a single one of those. So let's dig in on a couple of these topics, relevance and authority, so that you can really know if this is an area to focus on. So relevance, it's all about on-page factors of the pages that you're looking at. So search engines, they're going to look at the title tag of the page to see what the page is about. They're going to look at the HTML tags, the H1s, the H2s. They're going to look at the text that's actually on the page. They're going to look at the URL. And they're just going to see if the terms that people are searching for are in those areas. And if so, it's probably pretty relevant. The rest of the relevance factors are a little bit more complex. So we'll dig in here. So one is uniqueness. What Google does is they take a look at your web page, they make a copy of it, they scan all this text, then they go to every other page that they've indexed and they say, is there anything unique here? Is there anything I don't have? Because if there isn't anything I don't have, I have no need to index this, I have no need to rank it. But if there is, I'm going to try and surface that. That's good content. They also look at the freshness. So a page that's updated often, that is recently updated, it's just more likely that its information is going to be up to date, more likely it's going to be a good experience for users. They also look at where those keywords are located, right? So if you have a term that you're trying to rank for and the only place you talk about it is in your footer, that's not going to do as well as something that's in the main content area that Google expects people to read, right? So Google separates the page and the content area, the footer, the header, the left nav. Stuff's in the content area that people read, it's going to get treated as more relevant. They also look at the diversity of content types. So if you have a page that's got text, video, imagery, that's going to rank a lot better than something that's just text or just a video, because chances are it's a better user experience. The last thing they look at is the number of links on the page. So if you're linking to a ton of other sources on your landing page, then that's probably telling search engines that you don't have all the answers searchers need, and therefore you're not a good experience. Let's talk authority for a minute. Oh, last piece is, if you have a lot of ads on the page, chances are your worst user experience, chances are you won't be super relevant. So switching to authority, authority is all about off-page factors. So authority is really about two main things, the quantity and quality of external links to your page and to your domain. So a link from a newspaper site is gonna help your authority more than a link from my blog. Maybe not in 10 years, given the way newspapers are going, but right now it's gonna be more authoritative. The other things that they look at is, you know, how are people linking to you when someone else links to you? If someone's linking to Pinterest with the keyword home decor as the anchor text, that's telling Google something about what the site is relevant for, what it's authoritative about, versus a link that's click here, right? Other things they look for is the metrics that they get when they surface you. So if someone clicks on a Pinterest link and then they immediately click back to Google and do another search or click on another result, that's an indicator that the user didn't get what they expected from that result and you'll be less authoritative in the future. Similarly, when a site is ranked, search engines are gonna look at, what's the click-through rate versus people that have similarly been in that same round of spot? If you're getting clicked a lot less when you're surfaced than other sites, then chances are you're not as authoritative as they thought, you're less relevant. A few other things that matter for off-page is how you get linked from, you know, similar to that content area. If you're getting linked from the content area of another site, it matters much more than getting linked from the footer. And the diversity of link types. So if you are getting linked from blogs, newspaper sites, social media, that matters a lot more than just getting links from all blogs. There are some prerequisites before authority and relevance matter, and that's discoverability and readability. And to understand how that works, you need to understand a little bit about how search engines do their job. So search engines have crawlers. They go to all the web that they understand, and they follow all the hyperlinks that they find. So if you're not being hyperlinked from anywhere that they know, you're not going to get discovered, you're not going to rank. The next piece that's super important, which people get confused about a lot, is that they just read any content that they find on the page. And they have trouble reading anything but text in HTML. So they have trouble reading JavaScript, Flash, video, imagery. So if all your content is hidden in that, Google's going to have a tough time understanding what you're about and being readable. So you need to be discoverable and be readable, and this is a particular problem for Pinterest, right? Pinterest is 100% images. So by default, Google has no idea what's going on Pinterest. They have no idea what we're relevant for. So we have to work a lot to get our users to add descriptions of every pin that they bring in so that Google understands, oh, this is about home decor. Oh, this is about DIY. So you're bought in. You've checked, you've seen that there's a lot of search volume for what you're doing. You think you can compete. What's next? Well, what a lot of people ask me is like, hey, do you know any great marketers that can help me out with my SEO strategy? And I just say, stop. You're approaching it from the totally wrong perspective. Because SEO is not marketing. SEO is engineering and product driven. In order to be successful at scale in SEO, you typically need to make a lot of changes to your site to improve your performance. And at the risk of hurting my career, you don't need an SEO expert to come in and tell you what all those changes are. You just need to do experiments. And the reason why is that the rules of search engines are hidden from view and they change without notice. So a lot of these best practices have been gathered over time from doing experiments and seeing what works. But some of these can change, and if you're not doing experiments to measure if what you're testing is actually working, you might be wasting a lot of time on things that don't really help you. So at Pinterest, we do a ton of experiments for SEO. So we're adding content, we're adding new pages, we are improving the uniqueness of our content, we're helping Google discover more of our content, and we measure all of it in an experiment framework that we built specifically for SEO. An experiment framework for SEO is different from a typical Optimizely type experiment framework. Instead of separating users, showing one user one version, another user a different version, you actually separate page types. So we have over a billion boards on Pinterest today, and what we'll do is we'll say, okay, let's take 10% of those boards and let's change something. Maybe it's the title tag, maybe it's how we represent the pins. We'll show that to search engines, and we'll compare it to a control group where we haven't made any change. And what we'll do is we'll just see if we start getting more traffic than before to the pages we made the change. If we did, we'll roll it out to 100%. If it didn't, then we'll revert it back. Caveat to kind of building an experimentation culture with SEO is that you actually can't really experiment on building authority. Or at least I haven't found a good way to do so. So if any of you have great tips, let me know afterward. But if you don't try to build authority, every one of your competitors will, and it is long-term correlated to success. So you do need to do it. It is just much harder to say exactly what you're getting for it at every given moment. So a lot of people also will say, well, you know, I'm a mobile app business. Everything's going mobile. You know, should I care about this stuff anymore? SEO seems like a web thing. And, you know, I have the same answer from Reverend Lovejoy. The principles you follow to determine if SEO is going to be a great growth channel, they matter the same whether you're a mobile app or a website. Basically, you're thinking about, are people searching for what I provide? Can I rank if I, you know, put in some effort? And if you're a mobile app and that answer is yes, then you go build those landing pages and you take that traffic and you just, you know, tell people, oh, go text the link to yourself, or, you know, on mobile web, here's a link to the app store to go download it. But you absolutely shouldn't think that I'm a mobile app business, therefore, you know, SEO is not an opportunity for me to drive growth. So that's basically it for me. You know, connect with me on Twitter. I'm going to post the slides up on KCX Dental, which is my blog. If you want to work with me, we're always hiring for SEO and for growth. And use Pinterest heavily, please, so I can keep my job. Thanks, everybody.